Well, it is an amazing deal that once a year, and here we cycle around, and this is our very first Easter in our new worship space. It was just a little after Easter last year that we dedicated this space, and now here we are worshiping in it for our very first Easter season. And it's been a tremendous time. Thursday evening was just amazing as we celebrated that first Last Supper, right here. That was the time when Jesus set in motion what we now call Eucharist, or Holy Communion, or the Mass, or the Lord's Supper. We celebrated that together. On Good Friday, we were 3 hours here. That's just 2 days ago, spending the last 3 hours at the cross with the Lord Jesus, hearing what he had to say as he hung there and died, as well as worshiping him and being so moved in our adoration of him. And now here, Easter Sunday, celebrating that Jesus is alive. Now, once a year we have this service, and it's huge, worldwide. You've already seen celebrations from different parts of the world on television as the sun has been moving around the globe and different parts of the world have been celebrating Easter, Resurrection Day, Jesus being alive day. And here we are. But here's the reality. Every Sunday we gather, we celebrate the resurrection. You know, under the old law, it was the seventh day of the week that the church, the Jewish church, would gather and celebrate how good God was and worship him. But after Resurrection Day, the church moved that day to the first day of the week and included in it, as we do today, but every Sunday, that Jesus is alive. So every first day of the week is a memorial, a celebration, to the day Jesus walked out of the grave alive. I tell you this, that stone was moved away, not so Jesus could get out, but so that the women could come and see that he was really gone, and then pass around the news that he was alive. So every Sunday we do that. But in reality, if you know and love Jesus, every day is his day. Because we walk with him and talk with him. Because he is alive. If he weren't alive, we'd be into a dead religion. Just getting some teaching from the past, trying to philosophize about it and make application to our lives. But the heart of being a Christian is not application of ancient teaching. It's a living daily experience of a Jesus who is alive. So when I wake up, he greets me in the morning. When I drive to work, he goes with me. As I sit down at my desk, I can give the day to him. He is alive. Every day celebrates for those of us who know and love him that he is alive, because we share our lives with him. But to come back to today, I'd like you to turn to page 6 in your service sheet, which will bring you to the writing of the Apostle Paul as he sent a letter to the church in Corinth, one of the aristocratic art centers and worship centers of the Greco-Roman world. We still name a certain kind of architecture after Corinth, with Corinthian columns. It's still a brilliant piece of world history, is Corinth. But Paul went there and preached the gospel, and people became believers, and he ended up writing this letter to them. And this particular chapter, we're only going to deal with the opening verses, speak about the resurrection and how pivotal it is to everything we believe about the Christian faith. Before we come to the verses that you have right there in your service sheet, just a little further on, verse 14 of 1 Corinthians chapter 15, Paul says this: if Christ has not been raised, our preaching is useless. Well, maybe some of you have some real questions about our preaching, even if he is raised from the dead. But let me tell you something, without Jesus alive, anything we have to say is useless. So if you don't believe he's alive, you may think that what I'm saying right now is useless, because you're thinking, what's this all about? But he goes on to say even this much more. Not only is our preaching useless, but so is your faith. Useless if Jesus isn't alive. And then just a few verses on, it says even something more dramatic. At least as dramatic. Verse 17, he says this: if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile, and you are still in your sins. Then those also who have fallen asleep, that is died, have fallen asleep in Christ, are lost. If only for this life we have hope in Christ, we are to be pitied more than all people. So if you don't believe Jesus is alive, but you keep following the Christian faith and trying to live up to the standards he said, do you know what Paul is saying to you right now? You're pitiful. And the way southern people talk about you being pitiful, you really feel pitiful. I've got a daughter who's married to a southern boy from Tennessee, and she even talks like them all down there now. 5551919. I mean, she just talks. And I didn't raise her to talk like that. And she likes country music now. Unbelievable. You should hear her say, pitiful. And you know, southern people have a way of talking. They say, bless her heart. Ain't she pitiful? If you hear somebody from the South, Southerners will acclaim to this. If you hear them, somebody say, bless her heart, bless his heart, you know something else is going to come that says she better be blessed, because she's got next to nothing going for her. She's pitiful. Listen, if it's just for here and now, you're into Jesus, and there's no hope of everlasting life, you don't believe he walked from the grave alive, you think it's just a nice idea to kind of cling on to because we hate it when people die and they're gone, you are pitiful. Says the Bible. Not me. The Bible says you are pitiful. So it faces up to the issue, does it not? So as we come to the beginning of this writing in chapter 15, you see how Paul puts the cross of Christ and the death of Christ and the resurrection of Christ central to absolutely everything we believe. Follow along with me. Now, brothers, I want to remind you of the gospel I preached to you, which you received and of which you have taken your stand. What a strong statement that is, to take your stand. Not some nice tradition, not some wishful thinking. You have staked your life on it. When you take your stand on something, you have staked everything about yourself, with yourself, to that vantage point, to that belief. You've taken your stand on this. And then further it says this: by this gospel, you are saved. That's from your sin, and we'll come to that in just a moment. Rescued from the condemnation and hell you deserve because of your disobedience to God. You are saved from your sin. If you hold firmly to the word I preach to you, and another strong statement, to cling to it, to hold on to it firmly, not some pathetic effete association with Christian teaching and tradition. But you've grasped it, you've got it, And you cling to it. You hold it firm. Otherwise, you have believed in vain. And there is that word then. In vain means for naught. So he goes on. For what I received, I passed on to you as of first importance. I want you please to underline that phrase right there in your service sheet. And maybe in your own Bibles. I passed on to you as of first importance. That is of primary importance. This isn't some little piece of truth that's on the edges of things. This is the heart and gut of the Christian faith. What he's about to declare. So it's not from the periphery of what we think about Christian faith. It's not some associated and well-meaning teaching or important stuff even. This is the absolute pivotal point, the fulcrum, the thing of first importance, of priority, that he gives to them by way of this statement. And what is it? I passed on to you as of first importance that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures. Now, I don't have time. It's almost a digression to say, because it's underlined twice here, that it's according to the scriptures that he died, and it's according to the scriptures he walked from the grave alive. What's being addressed there is that it was prophesied ahead of time why he would come and what he would accomplish when he came. And the relationship between the crucifixion of Jesus and the resurrection of Jesus is this. That if Jesus had not walked from the grave alive, you wouldn't know that he died on the cross. You wouldn't know what he'd accomplished on the cross. Have you ever thought of that? That it's because he did walk from the grave alive, and it was borne testimony to by all these people who saw it. And I just put in parenthesis right now. Listen, in the Middle East, Arab Muslims are getting visions of Jesus Christ and coming to faith by the thousands. And you're not going to get that out of the secular media. But I had a man visiting here from the Middle East, and it's happening all over the place. And Aminejad, or whatever, however you say his name, one of his distresses is that he knows that throughout Iran, right now, lots of young men and women are becoming believers in Jesus because they can go online and secretly get the message of the gospel, and they're sick and tired of their rotation of violence and what's happening in their lives. And they're beginning to seek out online the Christian faith and come to faith and secretly be believers. But in addition, you'll hear of this one of these days. Every day, somewhere in Islam, they're getting an image and a vision of Christ. Now, I tell you that because Jesus is the Savior of the world and not just a few Westerners. Amen. Praise the Lord. He is the Lord of the Middle East. He died in the Middle East. He walked out of the grave alive in the Middle East. He's calling people from the Middle East and around the world to come and know him. More people are getting converted in China every day than the rest of the world put together. Watch out. The economic power of China isn't about them becoming a military force. They're going to become a gospel force worldwide. They already are. And it's an extraordinary thing. But I'm mentioning this to you because outside of Jesus walking from the grave alive and being alive, you would never know that he died on the cross. I love to ask the question, how many other people do you name out of the tens of thousands of people that the Romans executed by crucifixion? At one point, to subdue an uprising, they put every so many meters along a highway a crucified man. That's recorded in the history of their own people. So Spartacus, for instance, the movie, there's one name you know. He was crucified. Spartacus was one of thousands nailed to a cross and left there to subdue the people, put them in terror and horror of it happening to them. And you'd walk along the road and body after body would hang there, not just dying, but after they were dead, to warn you, don't mess with Rome. So Spartacus is a name you know. I know another one you know, and that's Peter, the apostle. But I tell you this, you wouldn't know about Peter. He was crucified upside down in Rome. You wouldn't know about the apostle Peter, but for the fact that Jesus was raised from the dead. Because his death would have been as meaningless as any other person who'd been crucified by the Romans. But when Jesus rose again from the dead, it put out there in history, and why we have crosses on everything that belongs to Jesus, that he came to die for the sins of the world. So what does Paul say as of first importance? That Christ died for our sins. The first thing he's going to tell you about the resurrection is that it authenticates the death of Jesus as a sacrifice for our sins so that we could be forgiven, know for sure we're forgiven, know for sure that all the guilt and the filth and the failure of the past is buried with him, and that as he walks out of the grave alive and goes to glory, one day we will be with him. The resurrection is not a piece of ancient history that we bury in dusty old books. It's a living relationship with Jesus Christ. And the evidence of his being alive is the evidence that God loves you. That when Christ died on the cross, he died for you. That the sins of which you are appalled can be forgiven. That you can invite a living Jesus into your life and know that you are born again of his Spirit and heaven is your home. So that you can see your wife and your children raised to know and love this Jesus. And know that when we die, heaven will be our home. And that we'll see one another again in glory. The cross is the centerpiece of the history of the world. How extravagant a statement is that? Because God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son to die on the cross so that those who believe in him should not perish, bear their own judgment, but have everlasting life. So Paul says, I delivered to you and passed on to you as of first importance, that Christ died for your sins. That's John Guest. We are a cross-centered church because it is of first importance. What do you think that cross is doing up there above my head? Why do you think we have a cross right in the heart of our church crest? Why are we preaching continually about the need of the cross? Why do you think Jesus left the Last Supper, the bread and the wine, as a memorial to his dying? He didn't say, remember my teaching, though he wants us to. He didn't say, remember my birth, though we do so. He said, you remember my death. Take bread and break it. It's like my body being broken on the cross for you. Drink my blood. My blood was shed for you. The cross is absolutely central. You cannot bypass the cross. You cannot bypass the cross and hope to get into heaven. You've got to come to terms with Christ and him crucified. Why? Because it is of absolutely first importance. And you know about it because Jesus did conquer death, and evidence that he had conquered sin because he came to life again and is still alive and still is the Lord of lords and King of kings. The Lord omnipotent reigneth. Hallelujah, hallelujah. So we sing as we proclaim it. So Paul tells us the meaning of the cross, and then he goes to the evidence of the resurrection, which verifies and authenticates what has happened on the cross. So what you've got here set before you is both what the cross means and then the evidence that Jesus is alive, so you can really believe in what he tells you the cross means. Let's spend a few moments with that in terms of the evidence concerning the resurrection of Jesus. Look at what it says here. That he was buried, this is verse 4, that he was raised on the third day, that's the resurrection, according to the scriptures, prophetic word of God from the Old Testament, that he appeared to Peter, then to the 12, that's the apostolic band. After that, he appeared to more than 500 brothers at the same time, underlined at the same time. This was no hallucination. Some of whom are still living. You can go and talk to them. You can't, but the hearers of this word could. Though some have fallen asleep, that is, have died. Then he appeared to James. That's James the brother of Jesus. That's not James the brother of John the apostle. James the brother of John was crucified, not crucified, but executed very early on. And what you read in Acts chapter 15, verse 13, is that James, the brother of Jesus, became the leader of the church in Jerusalem. So when Paul went back as a Christian who'd been preaching the word, the man who was leading the church in Jerusalem was James, the brother of Jesus. In Galatians chapter 1 and verse 19, from that epistle that Paul wrote, you've got a similar reference about James, the brother of the Lord. Now I'll tell you what's powerful about that. Reaching your family after you have come to faith is nearly one of the most difficult things you can do. The brothers and sisters of Jesus did not believe in him as the Messiah when he was alive on earth. It took his death and resurrection for them to come to faith and for James, his brother, to become a leader in the church. I mean, it's so easy to slip by this stuff. When I became a believer, my mother was not enthusiastic about it. I thought she would be. I was raised in a non-church-going family. I won't say that we were outright pagan, but we were certainly non-church-going. No Bible, no prayer. And since we were such raucous and difficult boys, I thought at age 18, when I came to know the Lord, my mother would be happy, because at least that would be one kid who might live straight. Do it right. She was not impressed. Neither were my friends, neither were my brothers. And I can't tell you how often it is when kids get enthusiastic about the Lord, the mum or the dad think they've joined a cult or something. I know wives whose hearts are broken because their husbands absolutely disdain their faith. Maybe you're a husband who's been dragged here by such a wife today. You'll be thanking her before you're done here this morning. I can't tell you how many kids in their adolescence who've gotten enthusiastic about the Lord, gone home to mum and dad just as I did, and they've met a stony, ice-cold response and rejection because of it. So the very fact that it names James, the brother of Jesus, as one of those bearing witness to his being alive, is yet another extraordinary evidence. But the most amazing piece is not even the 500 people who saw him at one time. You noted that I did say, concerning those 500, that it wasn't an hallucination. Because any psychiatric doctor will tell you it is impossible for two people to have the identical hallucination at the same time, there and then. And you've got 500 people, not just the apostolic band, but 500. In other words, as you get your mind around it, this was not make-believe. This was the real deal. He was alive. But that's not even the most extraordinary piece. The most extraordinary piece to my mind is that the author of this was Saul of Tarsus, who hated Jesus and hated Christians. And you heard as we read this that he said, I was born as of one out of due time or due season because I persecuted the church of God. He was an opponent of the gospel. He was present and helped organize the execution of the first martyr, Stephen. He was a serious opponent. He wasn't just skeptical. He went out of his way to find Christians and drag them into court. And that's what happened. He was on his way to Damascus to do exactly that. You read about it in Acts chapter 9. And what does he do but meet Jesus? When he arrives in Damascus, he knows Jesus is the Messiah. When he arrives in Damascus, he knows, he's computing very quickly, that Jesus really did die for his sins. Before he leaves Damascus, he starts talking about it. That gets him into trouble. You would think Saul, the opponent of the gospel, once he became a believer, all the other Pharisaical leaders would want to become believers too, because he was their hero. When he gave his life to Jesus, he became their dog. They wanted his life. They wanted him gone. They wanted him dead, just like they wanted Jesus out of their way. What really is astounding is that Paul is the primary preacher of the gospel. He's the primary writer of the New Testament. A Christian killer. A hater of Jesus. He became a follower of Jesus. We are sitting in this church. If you could connect the dots back from Christ Church at Grove Farm in 2007 and connect the dots back, they would lead to the Apostle Paul. Because he is the one who brought the gospel for the very first time to West, to the West, to the Greco-Roman culture. That's why he's talking to the Corinthians. He's crossed over from the East and the Middle East. He's now at the heartbeat of Western civilization, as we call it, speaking in Athens and speaking in Corinth, and people coming to faith. It's an amazing deal. I thought to myself, what would be comparable today? Who would have to become a believer? You know how skeptical some of you were when Chuck Colson became a believer? You know, the guy who trampled all over his grandmother to protect the president, Richard Nixon? Everybody thought he became a believer just to sort of lighten his load when he went to jail. But when he gave his life to prison ministry, and still is committed to the prison ministry, to others who've been in jail or are in jail, does that mean every other sick lawyer in the country became a believer in Jesus? Did the ACLU suddenly say, my goodness me, this must be true. Chuck Colson, that dog, became a believer. Not a chance. I thought maybe if Hugh Hefner became a Christian, some of you might just yield. That's what I thought this morning. I was thinking, who could it be? Don't you hate it when you see Hugh Hefner, that old man? I mean, he makes me look like a spring chicken. You see Hugh Hefner, a dirty old man with beautiful young women, scantily clad, all telling you how wonderful it is to have sex with him, this old man. You have to wonder how hard up those women really are. Reality is that they're in it for the cash. It's all a facade. It's all a game. But supposing I could tell you this week that Hugh Hefner gave his life to Jesus, has taken all his Playboy clubs and his Playboy magazine and all his online filth, and is now using the wealth from all that for Jesus. He's shut down his clubs. He's disbanded his magazines and his editorial board. And he's out there talking about Jesus. Would you become a believer then? And some of you are thinking, has Hugh Hefner become a Christian? Not that I know of. I just picked some outlandish renegade who, because he is such a swashbuckling sinner, has the admiration of the secular world. Do you think they'd all become Christians if Hefner became one? Not a chance. You've got to have your own personal encounter with Jesus. And what the good news is right here, right now, is that he's alive and present here. And you can experience him. And you can ask him to come into your life and forgive you all your garbage, your indebtedness. And start again as a new person. He really did die to become your savior, to rescue you from the hell you deserve because of your sins. That is real. And what makes it real is that he walked from the grave alive. Jesus is alive and authenticates everything by that act of resurrection that he said concerning his dying for you. So we're not here to just celebrate something monumental in the past, but to give every one of us an opportunity to yield to Jesus Christ right here, right now. So let me ask you to bow your heads with me. See the Lord Jesus present here, coming to right where you are sitting. He loves you as much right now. And you will hear more about that as we celebrate the Lord's Supper. But he loves you as much right now as the day when he died for you on the cross. And he gives you the opportunity to surrender your life to him. So see him coming right to where you are sitting. And in your heart, say to him, Living Lord Jesus, I've been running away from you for too long. You know what's been going on in my heart and life. You know the various reasons for my rejecting you. But today, on this celebration of your coming to life again, Lord Jesus, I want to surrender my heart and my life to you. I want to surrender my sin to you. All the skepticism to which I have clung, the lies I've chosen to believe, the rejection at the core of my own heart because I don't want you running my life. I'm done with all that, Lord Jesus. I'm ashamed of myself. And thank you that you haven't rejected me, that you give me this chance to come and surrender to you. So as I look you in the face, please, Lord Jesus, forgive me my sins. Come into my life. Fill me with yourself, with your spirit. Make me new and clean from the inside out. Give me new eyes to see things differently. Help me to set aside my native skepticism. Help me to put my trust and confidence in you, to take my stand here today, and then to cling to your promises that you will never leave me nor forsake me. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
You've been listening to a message delivered by Dr. John Guest, the pastor of Christ Church at Grove Farm in Sewickley, Pennsylvania. Christ Church meets at 249 Duff Road in Sewickley, and we'd love to have you join us. For service times and information, call us at area code 412 412-741-4900. That's 412-741-4900. You may also contact us at that number if you have a spiritual need or question. Christ Church is dedicated to reaching out to share the gospel of Jesus Christ with the world around us, to help us grow in our faith, and to find our personal ministry. Thank you for listening.
So may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face to shine upon you. The Lord lift up the light of His countenance upon you. Grant you His rest, His peace. So may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be amongst you and go with you and bless you. All God's people said, Amen.